Hi there, guys. I'm Chris Bowden, and welcome to today's equipment autopsy. I finally get to do a record player, and I am ridiculously excited about this because I grew up in a very heavily music environment. Like before I did that whole Geek Group thing, I owned a recording studio, and I've been DJing at radio stations starting when I was like 15 years old. So it's records are a thing for me, and I've taken apart a few record players when I was a kid and stuff like that, but I haven't got to do it in a million years, and this is just cool. So, in the tradition of like the kind of music I played on my show and the fact that I may or may not have DJed in a gay bar downtown for several years, the records that I chose for this are Karma Chameleon by Culture Club, because you have to have a little boy George. And then to go to the absolute opposite end of the spectrum, I have Police Done Tore My Playhouse Down by Elizabeth Smith, a song I have never heard before, but when you come across a record, and it's an old school, like before vinyl record, Police Done Tore My Playhouse Down. So that might be the theme song of the day. The downside is I can't actually play either of them because YouTube would throw a wobbly, but I'm allowed like 10 seconds or something. So just so I can get it stuck in everybody's head. And now it's in your head too. So we're going to look at record players and how they work. I'm not going to get too technical into the history. There's a lot of really cool history, and by all means, look it up. Look up the history of turntablism and the amazing things that Les Paul and all that did with these. There's a lot there. I could talk for hours about this stuff. But what I want to get into today, what I want to focus on, is the mechanical workings of what a record player is and how it works and what it does and why. And we've had this one sitting in the autopsy pile for a while, and I've been waiting for like a good day and a happy mood and be like, yeah, let's do that. And I have this Panasonic record player, which is just, it's terrible. This is a terrible record player. This is a good record player. If you can come across a Technics, as a rule, it's a good record player. Okay, especially any of the SL series. This is an SL5200, so it's decent, kind of skatey, like they're really fussy with the adjustment, but good record player. If you want a record player for your house and something for actually listening to music on, this is a good one. And if you want to see something, if you really want to get into record players and just see how deep that rabbit hole goes, check out, there's a website called like Hi-Fi Audio or something like that. I'm sure the post-production guys will get it right for me, but there's a website that sells things for people that have more money than brains, where you're going beyond audio equipment straight up into art, and they sell record players on there that, like, if a guy who owns a machine shop just decided to screw around for a summer and make a project and wanted to make a record player that weighs 1,000 pounds, that's a good place to go. So let's dig into this. Now, the cool thing here is we've done a lot of stuff with analog audio and like the reel-to-reel series and stuff like that. This is analog audio done mechanically, which is really cool. Like with CDs, you record stuff optically. Does this reflect more than this does? Things like that, pits and lands. With tape, you're dealing with a constantly varying magnetic field. And this kind of does that, kind of, because it gets to that point, but that's the transduction point from mechanical storage into electronic transmission. And that's the actual data on a record in here isn't stored optically, though you can read it optically. They do make turntables that work with a laser, which is really cool. But it's actually stored mechanically. There's a waveform engraved in a continuous helical spiral on the record. And that's really cool. In fact, here's your fun question that I'm gonna put in. I want you guys to comment on this. This record, oh, come on, give me a time. We don't have a time on this one. This one gives me a time of 4 minutes and 11 seconds for Karma Chameleon. And if it plays for 4 minutes and 11 seconds, and it's spinning at 45 RPM, how many grooves are on this record? There's your question. How many grooves are on a record that plays for 4 minutes and 11 seconds and spins at 45 RPM? So there's your question for the comments. Now, we're going to get into this one. This we'll talk about in a bit because I want to be able to show some stuff. But let's actually dig into this one. Now, we're going to start out. Let's go in order. Why not? Let's go in order. And I have the cool dino-lite over here. We've got this, and I love it. This is a dino-lite USB microscope. And, wow, I should clean that. One of these days, I should do a video on cleaning records. I'll give you a hint. It involves tight bond wood glue. But for now, I'm just going to run it dirty. I'm riding dirty, and I don't care. So I'm going to slip this under the microscope and see what we can see. All right, so what you're seeing there are the actual individual grooves in the record. And if we could zoom out, what we would see, especially with an old record like this, let me bring it around to a good spot. Maybe this will help. What the groove actually looks like is a wiggly line going back and forth. It isn't just a track, okay? So imagine putting your finger in like some sand or something, and you move your finger back and forth. That's exactly what it looks like on a record, just at a really, really, really tiny scale. When they made this, now it depends on the time frame. Going back this old, it's entirely possible that when this record was originally recorded, not this particular record, but the master for this record, they had a machine. They put a blank acetate disc in a machine, in a record lathe, and they had the band and the woman in the room. And she sang, and it was recorded onto the original, the first record. And from that, they would make the mother, which is just basically a metal record, and start stamping them out. But there was a time when that's how it was done, like in the early days, like with Les Paul and things like that. Les Paul would actually play his guitar, and it would be recorded on the record. And then he'd manipulate the records, and he did all kinds of stuff. And out of that, they ended up starting making mass-produced records. But it all began back then with recording a thing. Nowadays, you can walk into a recording studio today, in 2016, you can walk into a recording studio today and record your thing, and it goes on a hard drive, and they can take that hard drive and that electronic file, and that can go off to a pressing house, and they can make a record from the file on the hard drive. But back originally, it started out by recording the record. And if they did several sessions, you could be slightly different each time, which is kind of cool. So we've got our sound on the record. Now our job is to get the sound to the speaker. And here's the thing to really keep in mind. This is an analog signal. So the waveform on the record, the movement back and forth in the groove, that waveform is wiggly. So that waveform's job is to wiggle the needle in the record player. There's a little tiny needle under here, which has been heavily abused, but let's see if I can show it to you. Here, I'm going to move this, and we'll see if Steven can get a really tight zoom in on that. Let me hold it. Let me get it somewhere so it's very still. There, try it right there. So you can see the little needle right there on the tip. So that little needle vibrates back and forth. It gets moved by the groove. So there's two different motions happening here. Motion one is the turntable is turning the record around. Okay, so the turntable moves the record around. That movement around moves the groove past the needle. The needle stays stationary in this axis, in the rotational axis. But the record is going to, the groove itself is going to move the needle back and forth in this axis. Okay, it's perpendicular to the axis of rotation. So the record's moving this way, that moves the groove this way, and the needle gets moved back and forth. The amplitude and frequency of the needle moving back and forth in the record is the same as the speaker moving back and forth in its housing. If this moves at a middle A, 440 cycles per second, then the speaker moves back and forth 440 times a second. Same, same. And I'm going to try, I don't know if I'm going to be able to, but I'm going to try really hard to show that over here. We'll get to that. So that's what's going on. And then the needle goes, the needle moves. Let's see if we can, we'll take it apart, man. We'll get right in there. So the needle is going to move a little pickup, an electromagnet, and that magnet feeds an amplifier. Can I get you out? I can totally get you out. Okay. I want to take that head apart in such a way that you guys can see it. Now, this is pretty chewed up, but I'm going to give it a shot. I got to unplug that for now so I can get to my tools. Oh, that's seen better days. All right. That'll drop that out. So this is our cartridge. So you have the needle, and the needle sits in the cartridge, or the head. The whole, everything from here out is the head. This whole thing is called the tone arm. Good ones have a counterweight like this, and maybe some other fun bits. But this is our cartridge, and I'm just going to... Oh yeah, you're loving me, I can tell. I'm just gonna yank that right off. No, see, I've messed up the weight, now it's all screwed. So here's our cartridge, which I'll set right there. And you can see, this is our needle. And down here, you see that little rubbery thing? That's going to be the bottom of the coils. There's a couple magnetic coils. So here's our needle, and set that. I'll just put it up right there. Now let's start digging into this. There's a big spring clip, so we don't need that. You are not designed to be opened up, but you will yield to me because I want to teach people all about your happy inner workings. You know, I've never actually opened up one of these before. My entire life. I would like to do it without opening up my finger. Oh, it's riveted. Well, this is going to require now a pair of needle nose, maybe that pair of needle nose. And we'll just start breaking parts off till I get down to the inner chewy goodness that I want to share with you. Yes! All right. I think. I just got that rivet right out of there. And now it should open up nice. Oh, look at that. Okay, come on out. Don't be afraid. I won't hit you anymore. If you come out, otherwise, I'll beat the hell out of you. All right, there we go. Okay, so this is upside down, but I'm going to set it right there so you can get a really good look at it. Now, let's point out some things. I don't know why, but this is my pointy screwdriver. So the needle sits here's the needle, and this is actually two needles, so when one wears out, you can flip it over like that and use the other side, And you'll notice they're in slightly different locations. Like if you look at it here, there's a needle there and there's a needle here. It's referred to as a needle or a stylus, depending on who you're talking to and how snooty they are. So you can flip it over like this, and it just sits in the mount. And the way it sits in the mount is at this end down here, this snaps into a thing. There's a little thing that holds over it. And then this up here, now here's where it gets cool. If you look at this, I'm going to turn it up so you can see how it actually looks. See that little notch right there? That's where the needle sits. So this snaps into a thing, and the actual needle rests in that groove up there in about that position. All right? So the needle, this part gets held stationary, and the needle gets dragged back and forth by the groove. So the needle moves like this. As the needle, now that's a mechanical motion. As the needle moves, it pushes this back and forth. And this has a couple, it's a pickup. Now these can be crystal based, these can be magnetically based. It all depends on the era and type of the record player. But if you look at some mixing consoles, some amplifiers, things like that, old stereo systems of a certain era, especially in the 70s and 80s, they'll have two different inputs on the back. It'll say phono because it's a phonograph, which is a record player. And it'll have mag if it's a magnetic style, or CRY or CRYS if it's a crystal style. If it's a crystal style, they use a quartz crystal. But it's the same thing. What it is here is this is where the rubber meets the road. This is where the magic happens, and we convert mechanical energy into electrical energy, either through a magnetic system with a core and coil, very similar to a dynamic microphone, or it's done through a quartz crystal where it works like a crystal microphone. but really this is a microphone. And that gives me a really cool idea. You could do this. I'm just thinking out loud here, but I think this would work. I think if you took a good dynamic microphone, like a Shure SM58, and you put a drop of super glue, like you take the top off of it and get down to just the plastic diaphragm, right? And you take a needle like this and you cut it off. If you were to cut it off right about here, okay, just below the needle, all you need is a little stylus tip. You don't need all this. Get rid of all this. Cut it off right there. And you mount the microphone in a stand. And if you touch that needle, super glued to the end of the microphone, if you touched that to a record, it'd play music. I think that'd work. In fact, I'm almost certain of it. So now we've got an electrical signal. Now things get a lot easier. All the magic, all the real hard stuff happens down here in the head of the tone arm. The rest, stupid simple. So let's dig our way into this. I'm gonna set "Police Done Tore My Playhouse Down." Can you guys zoom in and get a shot of that for me? Because that's just the coolest thing. I'll try and tilt it out of the glare. "Police Done Tore My Playhouse Down." On the other side, "I'm going to see Mama." This is the best. All right, so let's, I bet I can power this up. Hadn't even thought about that till now. Why didn't you remind me? I always like to power it up and make it do something before we really kill it. I don't have enough cord. I'm cheating. I can't reach to plug it in the wall. Though you'd think, after so many years of doing this, one of my crack production team would like give me an outlet up here on the table, or at least a hanging extension cord or something would be cool. on the days when I'm dealing with things that might plug in the walls. So I'm just gonna never do this. It's dangerous. I'm gonna set that there. Okay, I got 120 volts AC. Let's give it a record. Now, this is kind of cool. You doing stuff? Oh, this plays 78. Okay, so this is kind of cool. This record player has this dingus here. Like, most modern turntables have just the peg, right? You put the record on, you put the thing on, you play the thing. Old school ones, you could load like an iPod. You could put a stack of records on them and they would hold a whole stack of records, like a few, okay, like three or four records. And that's, whenever you see this arrangement, that's what that does. So I'm gonna put this on here and flip over, and that's the hold down arm. Now let's see if it actually works. I'm gonna say it's a 10-inch record. And it'll drop the record, and then it tries to put the needle on the record, and it'll autoplay. And, oh yeah, stop, thank you. So, if we tell it, because it doesn't know how big the record is, if we tell it here, that it's a 7-inch record, it should do the same thing and start playing from way in the beginning. And it'll go and should put it over here. Yeah, like that. See, and that's just gonna fall off because there's no record, or there's no needle in here. So it's kind of a cool mechanism. It was really neat when I was a kid. That's so neat. All right, so we've got the hold arm, and this just kicks in. And it's neat how it works because you've got this shaft here and this offset bit. So you have the record comes down and sits on top of that. And then when it wants to let a record come down, it moves this through. And that lets one record down, but the other ones are held up there. So this just net kicks over and lets one record down. So, and the whole thing is spring mounted because they're vibrationally sensitive. And a common problem if you have a record player is if you have your big stereo sitting right next to it and you crank it up loud, you can get mechanical feedback through the record. So we're gonna take this out of its big ugly housing. I should turn that off. Because now it's gonna get violent in here. Okay, I don't need that. I like that it jiggles. And I get a screw out of it. Yeah, we'll take the bottom off first and see what we see. There's fun happening here. Let's get rid of that. Okay, so we'll pop this out. Unless it doesn't want to pop out. In which case, we'll cut it. Right past the strain relief. There's a piece of paper in here. Not only is there a piece of paper in here, if you look closely, you'll notice this piece of paper is ruled for what I believe to be music staff. Now, can anybody out there identify that logo? What's that? Can anybody out there identify that logo? I've never seen it before, but I'd like to know what it is. Comment in if you know. All right, so this is kind of cool. The output cables are just RCAs, and they actually plug in to the bottom Right there, the output cables just plug right into the mechanism. So this should drop right out. If I just pop those two clips, the whole thing should just disconnect from the bottom. So let's try that. I'm gonna have to get a little rawer with it. Okay, that just pops right out there. And this will pop right out here. So that comes off there. And we just undo a couple wire nuts. How long has it been since you've seen a wire nut in something like this? That's not an everyday thing anymore. And now I should be able to just lift this right. Yeah, look at that. I'll drop that back here. All right, there's my cutters. Okay, so now we have a little shaded pole motor, a switch, some mechanical linkage mojo, and I'm going to grab my cable and we can power this up and see the motor move. Now, this kind of motor you'll see a lot in consumer electronics. They're really common as microwave fan motors. So here, let's... Now what do I have to do to trick this into coming out? Oh, that's it. Ooh, you are not happy, and I'm very sorry for that. All right, let's... I want to play with that motor. Now are we... Let's see how we're driven. I think this is driven by a contact wheel. Some turntables are direct drive, some turntables are belt drive. Which is better depends a lot on who you're talking to. I think it depends a lot on the application of what you're using it for, but with belt drive, well, let's open this up and I'll see if I'm really lucky, this will be direct drive, this will be belt drive or something like that. So let's open it up and then I'll talk about that. Yeah, I think I'm gonna start breaking some chunks off. That'll do it. Okay, so we can get that piece out. And now I gotta get around to spring. I did that. So let's grab a nice long number two, like you. And see how much damage I can do to this thing. That's not gonna happen. That's a one. I need that screw out under the motor. Okay, and now I'm down into the land of circlips. Not a lot of audio equipment these days. Do you have to contend with grease? It's been a while. circlips and spring and grease. It's kind of fun. It's really cheaply made, which is funny because by today's standards, this would be just amazingly complicated. Yeah, and I can get whole pieces out. And this is just a big, complicated, intricate linkage of stamped parts. You don't really see a lot of CNC work in this. And this whole mechanism just works to manipulate the arm back and forth and drop the record on the thing. A bunch of grease that hardened a billion years ago. So there's the thing that moves the tone arm. Fun. I'll just set that right there. That's interesting. All right. Okay, I gotta change over to number one. Should get that. The cool thing is this was built in a time when if something like this broke, you could fix it. Gotcha. I really want to see under there. That's where all the cool stuff is. I'm trying to get wait a minute. Precision crafted in Great Britain by BSR. And spot welded. But That's how I get in there. It was hidden under the mat. Ha! Yes! Ha ha ha! All right, so. How do you work? How do we drive? This is driven by this drive wheel. That's our motor. And that's the wheel. Okay, so this spins. This is our turntable. And on the bottom of the turntable is this here. And it's got a paint on the inside, which I'm guessing is some kind of grippity paint. And the inside rim of this rides against this wheel. When this wheel is moved over and pressed against our motor, and that drives everything. So if I turn the power on, I have to be careful because I got open connections here. If I turn the power on and I press okay, so when this gets pressed over, it presses the switch, it turns the motor on. No, the motor's on. No, the motor's off. So when I press this over, it presses the switch, and that turns the motor on. You can see moving this lever moves the wheel, and if I push it, you can see the wheel moves to the outside. So the downside is, because this is all hidden between two layers of stuff, there's no way to actually see it happening with the lid on. But if I had... This is just a rubber wheel. And if I had that sitting here filling this space, it'd push against it and it'd drive the thing around. But that's how it happens. Oh my God. Okay, because I've been trying to figure out how did they adjust the speed. So this thing works at 16, 33, 45, and 78 RPM. How does it know? Like, how does it change gears? Where is its transmission? Because it's got to be kind of fussy about the actual RPM, because if you play it too fast, the record sounds sped up. If you play it too slow, you know, eh. So how does it change gears? And how do you make the cheapest, reasonably precise transmission you can possibly get? This is cool. So we've got our wheel here. This is just an idler wheel. Okay, it's not... It's just on a bearing. It's just a wheel that spins, right? And you push this wheel against the motor. And when you do that, you push the wheel against here. So this is a fixed diameter, and the wheel is a fixed diameter, and the motor output armature shaft is a fixed diameter. But it's not. It's four fixed diameters, and that's cool. So this never changes, and this never changes, but... If you look at the motor output shaft, I'll tilt this up so you can see it. It's going to be kind of a weird angle, and it's black on black, and I'm sorry for that. But you can see that the motor output shaft is four separate diameters going down the shaft. There's the big one down here, and then a step down, then a step down, then a step down. And as I move the switch, the selector switch for speed, that's 16, that's 33, that's 45, and that's 78. So at 78, when it pushes against the thing and we start the motor, now I want you to note how fast this turns around, okay? So if I push this over, okay, see how fast it's going? Now, we'll shift down to 45. Oh, I gotta push it here. And it's a lot slower. Now let's shift down to 33. It's kind of broken, and it's not liking this. I broke it. It may be because there's parts missing on the bottom. Let me see if I can do it manually. Oh, that's what you do. Okay. Yeah, remember that thing I broke off? All right. Oh, yeah, I got you figured out. All right. So there's 78. There's 78. And I'll push it against the thing. And you can see how fast it's going. So there's 78. And it's really, really, really fast because it's pushing against a really big part on the bottom. Right? So it's spinning really, really fast. Now I go down a step. And now when I push against it, is that one step or two? That's one step. Okay, so I go down one step, and now when I push against it, we're at 45, which is still pretty fast. And now I go down another step, and we're to 33. And you can see it comes up the shaft to the next step. And now we're at 33. And when I do the next one, this takes us all the way down to 16. And that's how it changes gears. And it does this through this step mechanism on the back here, this thing. You can see that, boom. Okay, and that drags it up and down. So that's pretty cool. Now, let's turn the power off. And I want to get this motor out of here. What's holding you in? Those three clips. All right, I can do this. Clip one, clip two, clip three, boom. I'm gonna take out that clip two just because you were looking at me funny. Yeah, this big one down here. Because we'll talk about cams. Check that out. That's pretty. There's a big follow cam here. This is direct driven off the center here. It's flipped upside down. And it moves this cam, and this cam is what moves the tone arm in. So that's cool. All right, and now the whole motor should fall right out the bottom. And I'll take that little switch out, because that's hooked to the motor. Oh, there is no way. Check this out. All right, so I saw this and I thought, oh, it's an old micro switch, because you look at it and it's a little black rectangle with some wires out the bottom and a couple screws. I take the screws out and this isn't some old micro switch. It's actually like a specifically made switch for this. So we'll zoom way in. You can see the motor contacts. Look at that. So I got a pair of 110 volt open contacts right here. That means I should totally turn the power on. Boop. And now the motor spins. But what I'm going to do, because I really want to get into this motor, is cut these here and here and get rid of this mess because it scares me. All right, so let's hook the motor up. Now this is a cool motor, and at some point in the future when we do a thing on electric motors, I'll talk about this in more detail. But for now, I'm gonna put a Wikipedia link, and I want you to look this up and check out how these work, because it's kinda cool. This is an induction motor, and on the back, you'll notice there's an armature. But all this has is a coil, a core, and an armature. And nothing else. There's no brushes, there's no commutation rings, there's nothing. And it immediately spins up and locks right onto a specific speed. This motor is synchronous. And that's how they control the speed. This motor, if you vary the input frequency of the power, the speed of the motor will change. But the voltage, it just gets louder. It doesn't go, it just gets softer because it's losing power. The speed doesn't drop until you get way down there, like way down. So that's pretty cool. All right. We have completely dismantled a turntable. And the first person to answer correctly on my question here of, we have 4 minutes, 11 seconds for Karma Chameleon. It's a 45 RPM record. How many grooves are on the record? The first person to correctly answer in the comments will get this in the mail. I will send this off to you, and you can have it on your desk as your prize. Because it's the most awesomest thing ever. Duh, why would you not want that? So there you go. That's the look at the record player. And now we can look at all of this together, but I can't turn on any audio. So we just got to turn off the sound. So this is everything working. And this record player has some, that doesn't look right. So this record player has some interesting stuff happening. First off, it's skating like crazy despite having messed with the auto skate a bit. On the sides of this, because this is something the other record player didn't have, I want to show you this. Thank you. You see these? These funny, shiny spots on the side. You'll see this on a lot of record players. These actually serve a pretty cool purpose. But I can't show it to you on camera. You have to go explore this for yourself. Because of the way video works, this won't work. But what these are is for a strobe light. And it's so that when the record is playing at the proper speed, you can look. There's a light right here, okay? And you can see the red light, the really soft red light. And that really soft red light is a strobe light. And when this is playing at the right speed, you can see off the thing, you'll see light reflect off those, and it's so that you can visualize the speed. These move by at a certain frequency, and the light blinks at a certain frequency, and this does some basic electronics so that if this is moving at 33 and a third RPM, one of these will look stationary. If it's moving at 45 RPM, another one of these will look stationary. And you use this to tell if your speed is on or not, because on this particular one, you can. There's a switch here that says quartz or adjustable. And if it's on quartz, there's a little quartz crystal inside that's setting the timing, and that's what your speed is locked to. And if you go adjustable, like if you're a DJ and you're doing beat matching or something like that, you can twiddle this knob and adjust it from 3% fast or 3% slow. And these can tell you about where you are. So you'll see this on a lot of record players. So go out and find a record player with this along the side and twiddle with it, and you'll get to see the whole strobe light effect thing happening. So there's a look at exploring record players, and I want to thank everybody for hanging out with me and tinkering with this and getting to see all of the basics of how record players fundamentally work. So thank you. I'm Chris Bowden, and you're not, and that is this equipment autopsy. So as always, we'll see you next time.